Voy a empezar a grabar. Okay, greetings, saludos y buenas tardes a todos. Thanks for accepting this invitation to this president panel. We are pleased to share that for today we have more than 300 people registered from heads member institutions in Puerto Rico, United States, and Latin America. But we would like to recognize the participation of some of our board members, like Gladys Nieves, president of EDP University, Dr. Maria Hernandez, president of Atenas College, also Dr. Javidan Rodriguez, president of University at Albany, and Dr. Tomas Iseket Neve, president at Bronx Community College, and other board members. Also, we would like to recognize the surprising presence of Dr. Nixa Hernandez, our former head's executive and my mentor. Thank you for being here as well. And also, we would like to recognize Dr. Hilda Colón Plomey, Vice President of Middle State Commission of Higher Education, who is also here with us. Also, we welcome institutions like Departamento de Educación de Puerto Rico. We have a lot of teachers also joining us. Head Start Program, Upward Bound Program, Kaiser University participants, Georgia Tech participants, also from Palm Beach State College in Florida and Chemeketa Community College in Oregon. We also have one international institution participating from Universidad de José María Matías Delgado in El Salvador, and also our colleagues from Universidad Cooperativa de Colombia, who is one of our members, and today we are having as a panelist the chancellor. Also, we have organizations like Internet Society Puerto Rico Chapter, Partners of the Americas, and also we have a registration from the Financial Oversee and Management Board for Puerto Rico. Thanks to all for accepting this invitation and for your time. First, for the ones who are related to HEDS, I would like to share some words about our history. And since our inception in 1993, the HEDS Educational Technology Services, that is the complete number for HEDS, formerly known as Hispanic Educational Technology System, has been a pioneer in supporting the development of distance learning initiatives across colleges and universities in Puerto Rico, mainland United States, and Latin America. Back then, was the first bilingual telecommunications consortium of colleges and universities dedicated to widening the access of Hispanic to higher education and training opportunities through educational telecommunications and distance learning. Today, we serve more than 40 Hispanic serving higher education institutions and emerging ones. And our mission is to promote, support, and increase the capabilities of member institutions to enhance the Hispanic Latino student success, student access, retention, and success in higher education through the strategic integration of technology. HEDS support and value has been widely known among its members for more than 25 years of our history. However, the organization's work has been increasingly relevant during the COVID-19 pandemic and enhanced its services to provide ongoing support to the academic community in this new scenario. Over the past month, HEDS has produced and offered over 20 tutorials in Spanish and English with students ambassadors on how to access our free services that are at the Student Placita in the HEDS Virtual Plaza. Also, two student leadership showcase online tours were held to reinforce student leadership skills, and 10 webinars in Spanish with 4 additional webinars in English on distance learning were coordinated to support faculty and administrations. In addition, the spring issue, volume 10 of the HEDS Online Journal, our peer review journal, was published with 9 articles that offer insights that are pertinent to the current environment, as well as online interviews with key corporate partners. To continue these efforts, presidents from different HEDS member institutions in Puerto Rico, United States, and Latin America were invited to participate in this HEDS virtual panel to share their expertise and lessons learned during the COVID-19 pandemic, and also their thoughts on the future of higher education from their perspectives of their academic communities and student populations. We truly appreciate the time and availability of the presidents who accepted the invitation to be part of today's panel. But before we start our panel formally, moderated, by the way, by President Carlos Morales. He's the president of the Connect Campus of Tarrant County College, and he's also our new head chair elected on the board of director meeting we held yesterday. And by the way, congratulations again for your election. We would like to give some important announcement. First, this event is being recorded and will be shared on the same webpage in the HEDS website that you register. Please maintain your microphones all time in mute, a mute all the time to avoid any interruption, please. Second, for those interested in obtaining a certificate of participation, it must be requested by email at info@heds.org within 7 days after this event. Please include on your petition email your full name, the date and the title of these webinars, and certificates will be only sent to those who meet these criteria. And finally, and third, at the end of the panel, the moderator, Dr. President Carlos Morales, will invite participants to ask questions. Please use the chat to write your questions or comments, and please specify if you want a specific panelist to answer your question. So thank you so much for accepting this invitation. And now please welcome President Carlos Morales, who will be the moderator, of this panel. Go ahead, President Morales.
All right, good afternoon. Thank you, Jubelkis, for the introduction, and welcome everybody. Good afternoon. Happy to be this afternoon hosting this panel. This afternoon with me, we have the presence of five presidents: Dr. Carlos Vargas, president of Southeast Missouri State University; Manuel Fernos, president of Inter-American University of Puerto Rico; Dr. Tomas Morales, president of California State University San Bernardino; Dr. David Gomez, president of Hostos Community College, part of CUNY; and Dr. Maritza Rondon, Chancellor of Universidad Cooperativa de Colombia. So again, thank you everybody for your willingness to participate in this panel and share some of your perspective. As you know, we are living unprecedented times, and higher education has not been the exception. So with that said, we wanted to seek the perspective and the experience, as well as lessons learned so far from various sectors in higher education. The represented presidents are from two-year, four-year, and private institutions, as well as public institutions in the United States and in Latin America. We have divided the panel in three topics, and hopefully we'll be able to provide you with perspectives and information that you can take back to your institutions. The format will be
Carlos, yes. Excuse me, if I can interrupt, I just see below you, President Ricardo Fernandez. Hi, how are you? He's one of our former members and a part of the advisory committee. It's a pleasure to see you. Thank you so much. Go ahead. So sorry.
No problem. Welcome. So with that said, the format is each panelist will have 3 minutes to answer the questions, and we will allow a time for questions at the end. So that's the format, and those are the housekeeping rules we wanted to share this afternoon. With that said, let's just start with the first question, and if you can tell us about any additional policies and procedures your institution developed to shift for the assurance of student retention, specifically in serving Hispanic students. What technological resources have you provided, and how did you provide these resources? I would like to for this to start with Dr. Carlos Vargas from Southeast Missouri State University.
Thank you very much, Carlos. It's a pleasure for me to be here. Thank you for the invitation. Let me just share with you that first the bad news. The bad news is we're not a Hispanic serving institution. The number of students that we have from Hispanic countries is actually not very large. We're about 10,000 students total. And we have a few hundred that are Hispanic. We are trying to grow that population, and I think we're making good progress by attracting students from the St. Louis area and also from Kansas City and some rural areas around Cape. We are located in a city that's about 45,000 students, individuals in it. Let me just quickly share with you, without going into a lot of detail first, some of the things that we've done. First of all, we have moved quickly to implement a credit, not credit, grade option for students, to recognizing that they were going to be having difficulties with a new learning environment that we had to go into with not much than a week or so of advance notice. So we had that credit, no credit option for the students to opt for. We also eliminated registration holds for students with an account balance raised the past from $200 to $500. Our analysis showed that in quite a number of students who owed up to $200 or so were not being allowed to register. So we raised that that threshold. And also we had some holds for students that had not participated or completed My Student Body, which is an educational program aimed at raising awareness of social violence on campus. And then students, we had some minor disciplinary obligations. So we eliminated those registration holds. We also put in place an effort to contact by phone the students, as many as possible, in particular the ones that were high risk. The staff and the faculty from the university, we had about 150 individuals that participated in making phone calls to students and encourage them to actually re-register for the spring semester. We put in place a very comprehensive effort to also connect with them through videos. In many of the videos, I was personally involved in them, encouraging the students to hold on tight and to deal with this waters that we were navigating that were certainly uncharted. So I'm not sure how much time I have already used.
30 seconds. You have 30 seconds.
Okay, so and then we transitioned to a Zoom environment using remote learning sort of approaches. So I will stop there just to make sure that I don't take any time from my colleagues on the panel.
Sure. Thank you. I would like Manuel Fernos, president of Inter-American, to address the same question. And again, in serving Hispanic students, what technological resources have you provided and how did you provide those resources?
Oh, sure, Carlos. Definitely, in Puerto Rico, we had a lockout starting March 15th. By the way, the day before that, the government officially said that there was going to be no lockout, and suddenly they changed their minds, and so we had no notice that we were going to have a lockout. That meant that in the case of Inter-American, we had 2 weeks of lockout, and I think we used that time very wisely to get ready for what has happened after that. Fortunately, before the lockout, Inter-American has had more than 20 years of experience on online teaching. At the time of the lockout, we already had 67 academic programs authorized by the local council on education and middle state, accredited by middle states. So we had the experience in terms of of the academic program. So we had the trained faculty for that. And also very important to mention that over 20,000 of our students take at least, and that's more than 50% of the student body, they take at least one online course every year. So there's a tradition in Inter-American. Nevertheless, it was a challenge. It was a challenge because we had at the time 279 academic programs that were being taught on site. Okay. And that meant that we had to train and maybe further training for the faculty. In fact, almost 1,200 faculty members were trained within that 2 weeks period to use Blackboard Collaborate Ultra. I think it was a success. Also, we used that time to teach students on how to use Blackboard Collaborate Ultra. Although I have also to mention that many of our students take what we call hybrid courses. That's once a week on-site meeting, and the other rest of the week they go online. So there's a tradition within the faculty also and within the student body.
30 seconds.
Okay, so, and I think we have seen the results. Our retention improved at the end of the semester. We improved retention by 2%. I think it was a success, definitely.
All right, thank you. Tomás Morales, if you can share with us your experience in regards to how you presented those resources for students. Go ahead. And you are on
mute. Very similar to my colleagues. We're a quarter campus. So around mid-March, about a week before our final exams were to be administered, we pivoted and moved all our final exams virtual. And we're very worried. Literally the day before the first day of final exams, we had to pivot and move all of our final exams virtually for the winter quarter. And so it worked out very well. Our incomplete rates, our DWF rates all dropped. Our students did remarkably well. Our faculty did an incredible job. Some of the major policy changes that we employed for the spring, like my colleague Dr. Carlos Vargas, we also instituted a credit, no credit option, and students are allowed to employ that option after they receive their grades for the spring quarter. In other words, if the student is unhappy with their grade, they can then elect to have a credit or no credit PF, pass or fail option. And the students initiate that process by going online in what we call My Coyote service portal, and they initiate that themselves. We extended our library laptop lending program, and we distributed over 400 laptops. We distributed over 200 hotspots. There are areas in San Bernardino and Riverside County where connectivity is very weak or very spotty. And so we provided hotspots to students at no cost. We underwrote that cost. We also provided opportunities for students who did not have a hotspot to actually access the internet in the parking lot of our campus. So our Wi-Fi was able to be accessed. If you parked your car next to a building in a parking lot, you were able to access Wi-Fi services.
20 seconds.
Yeah, okay. We also provided, we used the CARES funding. We received about $13 million from the federal government for a distribution of financial aid to our students. And then we added another $1 million for undocumented students and for international students.
All right. Thank you, Tomas. I would like David Gomez to provide his perspective again on the same question. What technological resources have you provided, and how did you provide these resources? Go ahead.
Before I do, I just want to point out to both Manuel and Carlos that I thought we were supposed to wear guayaberas. I wore my shirt and tie yesterday, but that's a discussion for another day.
Mine is not iron. That's the issue.
like my colleagues, we implemented the credit, no credit policy. We increased the flexibility in terms of deadlines. I mean, all of the things that common sense would dictate in these extraordinary times. We had to do a wholesale conversion to distance learning. Of our 1,400 sections that we offered on average, only 200 were online at the time. So in the middle of the semester, we needed to make this complete flip, and we did, thanks to our provost and our faculty. God bless them all. For us, residing in the poorest congressional district in the United States, and that is a fact, what we saw was that the digital divide became crystal clear. We have over 300 students who are living in shelters with their families. We have students who do not have devices, or if they have one in their homes, now had to share them with their children or with their domestic partner because they were doing work remotely. And like Tomas, also students who do not have ISP providers. So even though you're in the middle of a metropolis, they do not have internet access. So we just geared up and we distributed over 700 laptops to students. We got our public safety staff, because they couldn't take public transportation because of the pandemic, to do curbside deliveries. We distributed over 100 hotspots to students, and like Tomas, at no cost to the student. We essentially converted our entire curriculum from in-person to online in a matter of weeks. And like my colleagues have reported, much to my surprise, attendance was up, participation was up, the faculty remain engaged, and either because of the crisis or because of their dedication, everybody seemed to rise to the challenge. What it pointed out for us is the huge disparity, especially among community colleges and any institution that serves poor students. The assumptions that we make about how easy it was to convert, the technology, ironically, was easy. Distributing resources was a lot more of a challenge.
All right. Thank you, David. Doctora Rondón, yo le voy a traducir su contestación. La pregunta es la misma para los estudiantes hispanos. Hold on. Okay. Para los estudiantes hispanos, ¿qué recursos tecnológicos le proveyó la institución y cuál fue la estrategia que utilizaron para proveer los mismos? Adelante.
Gracias, muy buenas tardes para todos. Les ofrezco disculpas, voy a hablar en español. Primero quiero agradecerle a Yubelkis por esta invitación y poner un poquito en contexto. He escuchado detenidamente las respuestas de mis antecesores y poner un poco en contexto que la Universidad Cooperativa de Colombia es una universidad privada. Nosotros, los recursos con que financiamos toda nuestra actividad, lo generamos nosotros mismos. No recibimos auxilios de ningún ente de gobierno en nuestro país. Tenemos 42,000 estudiantes que están ubicados en 18 municipios de Colombia. pero provienen de casi todos los municipios de nuestro territorio nacional. Es decir, son estudiantes que no viven realmente sus familias en los sitios donde nosotros estamos impartiendo el servicio de educación. Los apoyos que les tuvimos que dar fueron muchos. Estos estudiantes son de estratos 1, 2 y 3, estratos socioeconómicos muy bajos. Y una vez se activó la cuarentena, nosotros entramos aquí en la segunda semana de marzo, ya estábamos todos completamente aislados en aislamiento social en sus en las casas nuestras. Las universidades físicamente cerramos los campus desde el 16 de marzo y empezamos a impartir la educación remota, como se llama aquí. Nosotros en dos semanas teníamos los 42,000 estudiantes, tuvimos que financiarles algunos conectividad, no tenían, hacerles entrega y préstamo de computadores, que tampoco tenían, flexibilizar en muchos sentidos el momento de la estabilización de ellos, porque cuando empezamos a la segunda semana dimos un tiempo como de dos semanas para podernos organizar y estar todos, profesores, administrativos y todos haciendo nuestro rol con las tecnologías. Muchos de ellos se fueron a sus casas y allí teníamos cerca de 2,000 estudiantes en la tercera semana de clases que ya no tenían conectividad. Pero hicimos unos esfuerzos muy grandes, campañas de apoyo, donaciones y demás. Hoy les puedo decir que tengo solamente de los 42,000 estudiantes, 400 que no pudieron entrar y acceder a los contenidos académicos porque están en zonas del país. Yo tengo muchos estudiantes que son indígenas y están en sus resguardos, en sus espacios, y ellos con su cultura y sus tradiciones no los dejaron salir a algunos sitios donde tenían conectividad, y otro número más pequeño por orden público que la guerrilla no les permitía movilizarse hacia los lugares donde había el internet. Flexibilizamos mucho, pero logramos mediante apoyos, insisto, entregarles computadores prestados a aquellos que no tenían, en darles unos recursos para la conectividad y agradecer muchísimo, creo que fue un tema muy importante, los profesores cómo flexibilizaron y cómo nos ayudaron a que todos fueran entrando en su nivel de formación.
Gracias. Chancellor Rondon stated that, first of all, she wanted to thank the invitation from HEDS to share the experience from the Colombian perspective. She describes her institution as a private institution with no government support, so they drive their revenue through tuition. Their institution serves 42,000 students, and they come from approximately 18 municipalities in Colombia. The institution in this particular situation had to provide lots of support to their students, the majority because of low socioeconomic backgrounds. And this started early on in March. By the second week in March, they were on lockdown. Specifically 16 of March, and the experience has been that within 2 weeks they were able to move the majority of those students to web access, deliver laptops, and they provided support in regards to the stability in terms of emotional and additional student services. If you will, the staff of the institution was very involved, all hands on deck during that situation. And the 2,000 students were not able to be connected by the third week, but then that got resolved. They received a lot of donations from private institutions and charity organizations in the area. And one important detail is that of the 42,000, only 400 students were not able to access at all the services provided, in this case remotely, because in this case they are indigenous students and they have traditions and beliefs that is a little challenging for them to come out. And they also had the challenge of the guerrilla not allowing the free movement, if you will, of citizens. So thank you for that answer. Let's go to the second theme, if you will, and this is related to student support and student retention. And the question at this moment is, how are you keeping students engaged and comfortable in the online learning environment? And the other part is, if you can discuss how your institution supported disproportionately low-income students during the COVID-19 situation. And I would like to start again with Chancellor Rondón. So, Rectora, por favor, si usted puede contestar esta segunda pregunta, comenzamos con usted y tiene 3 minutos. Adelante.
Perfecto. Bueno, mira, nosotros, paralelo a todas estas estrategias para que los estudiantes estuvieran, no desertaran de todo este proceso, activamos un programa muy interesante que llamamos Bienestar Positivo, porque estábamos viendo que había un elemento que nos iba a afectar, además de la incertidumbre, el uso de las tecnologías, de acomodarse a las nuevas formas de aprender, y era su salud mental. Entonces, allí empezamos a trabajar, desarrollamos un micrositio y pusimos a disposición cerca de 200 psicólogos entre profesores y personal que teníamos contratado, y empezamos a ayudar tanto a profesores como a estudiantes para que ellos fueran de alguna manera, con el apoyo del profesor y con este bienestar positivo, adaptándose a, no solamente a aprender en esta modalidad, sino también a manejar los diferentes roles que tuvieron que asumir en un momento dado los que eran padres de familia, cuidar los niños, hacer actividades de la casa que no lo hacían antes, en fin, una serie de elementos que fueron apareciendo en esta nueva cotidianeidad que teníamos. Allí tuvimos unos elementos interesantes, se hacían consultas por telepsicología. También hablamos mucho con los profesores para que ellos entendieran la nueva realidad en el modo de racionalizar tareas y mirar cómo iban ellos también generando unos recursos adicionales para que los profesores, los estudiantes y los profesores se sintieran a gusto. Definitivamente, cuando tenemos estudiantes de bajos recursos, nosotros hoy en la universidad, y esta es la segunda pregunta, estamos mirando cómo damos becas, cómo sacamos inclusive unos descuentos, conseguimos financiación a cero interés, estamos con unos aliados para que nos ayuden a generar unas líneas de crédito especiales para los estudiantes. La universidad está asumiendo la financiación, los descuentos, y estamos haciendo un proyecto que lanzamos esta semana de consejería, llamando a cada uno de los estudiantes y si se puede involucrar a las familias en esas llamadas para poder caracterizar mucho más la situación del estudiante y darle una solución personalizada, ya sea para financiación, ya sea para que ellos tengan aconsejarlos en el itinerario de formación o inclusive si tienen algunos problemas de salud mental. Entonces, todos estos recursos que estamos poniendo a disposición de nuestros estudiantes, tenemos una expectativa muy grande que la matrícula del segundo semestre no sea un impacto tan grande como se está pensando en Colombia, que va a ser del 50 o 40% de disminución.
Gracias. Chancellor Rondón states that they quickly scrambled to minimize the any drop rates or losing students, because they implemented a program called Bienestar Positivo, and that addressed mental health and other aspects of helping students maneuver, and as well as faculty maneuver through the sudden change of life due to the pandemic. They developed a microsite, a small website, where they converge the service of 200 plus psychologists, and this is the service Bienestar Positivo that then supported faculty and students. They also included aspects of adapting to the new way of life, specifically the new way of learning, because of course online and face-to-face are two different things. This program also included elements of how people could then transition and work even in regards to managing house chores, because now people are spending more time in their house. they implemented this a process called telepsychology as well. And again, new ways of conducting the work that was previously done face-to-face. Part of the concept also addresses with faculty how a homework can be designed and delivered in a way that is different for the circumstances in which everybody is now living. And that also aimed at creating new ways in which learning is interesting and of course of good quality. In regards to the support of low-income students, she indicates that the institution has worked with other entities to and has secured financing options at 0% for students. The university is involved in that process. And it also has started a program to provide counseling to students, and the goal is to call each student and provide as much of a personalized experience for them. So that's the way they are doing that aspect in Colombia. I would like to for David Gomez to answer the same question again: how you are keeping students engaged and comfortable in the online learning environment, and if you can help us learn how your institution supported disproportionately low-income students during the pandemic.
Well, I think we approached this on parallel tracks. One was we retooled our business practices. So things that we don't think about, like students filing forms, getting financial aid certifications, we made sure that there were VPNs set up so that our staff could work remotely and would have access to all of their files. We also rerouted the telephone numbers. I mean, we don't think about these things, but if a faculty member or a staff member uses their personal cell phone, now you know several thousand students have that information, it becomes a little bit of a challenge. So we worked very hard to create this virtual environment, both from the business side and the student support side. We provided through our student success coaching unit regular weekly follow-ups with all of our students on a one-to-one basis. Our ed tech training development office provided what they call the Are You Ready webinars for students who had to make this transition in the middle of the semester. And we've engaged our student government to provide town hall meetings, Zoom meetings with as many students as we could bring together, because there's a huge sense, and I don't know if anybody else is experiencing that, of isolation that we're all feeling, but that includes our students who do not interact with their friends, their colleagues, their faculty members, to try to encourage that. On the support side, we have maintained our food pantry open throughout the pandemic, and students can come and get food for free. We have a partnership with Goya Foods that has been very generous to us in terms of contributions. We've made arrangements with many of the local restaurants that on a rotating basis provide at least one free hot meal a day to OSTO students throughout the week so that they can avail themselves of that resource. We have also created, or we had, an emergency fund that we've always made available to students who find themselves in crisis. And we've bolstered that fund significantly. And we find that students need money for rent, for utility bills, just because many of them, if they had jobs, are now unemployed and the unemployment benefits are not sufficient. So, we've tried to provide everything, including through our website, the Hostos Helping, because if students need support with housing, legal issues, health issues, how can they get that information? Who can they go to? If a member of their family has been affected, what does that mean for them? So, we have been, like everybody else in this country and everybody else on this call, trying to figure it out as we've gone along, but never losing sight of the needs of our students in this unique situation.
Thank you. Tomas, the same question, please.
Certainly. So we made it clear to our students that their well-being
comes first, that they and their family's health and safety should never be compromised. So this past spring, 100% of our courses were delivered virtually, either online or using virtual modalities, Blackboard, Zoom, et cetera. Beyond that, our top priority has been ensuring our students have the resources to continue their academic progress and succeed. Faced with restrictions forcing staff to telecommute, we instituted an emergency telecommuting policy for our staff. We focused efforts on making academic advising, counseling, tutoring, IT assistance, and other student services available by phone, email, and Zoom. We established a quick guide on the university's website, providing links to information services and FAQs. Students were provided with training for virtual learning. Mm-hmm. And access to free software and virtual computer labs, along with supplying assistance and training for virtual teaching prior to the start of the spring quarter. Faculty were given guidelines on best practice. So we delayed the spring quarter for 1 week to allow faculty to get ready to teach those courses virtually. Communicate early and often, clearly set all expectations for attendance, participation in assignments, foster communication and collaboration among students. The university arranged emergency housing for those with no alternative living facilities, with all such housing complying with all physical distancing requirements. We have a food pantry. So we provide food for students that are food insecure. And that food pantry is right on campus. This summer, so next fall will be our first semester as a semester campus, our first year. We just finished converting from a quarter campus to a semester campus. So That was the a four-year process to convert from a quarter system to a semester system. But we will be 98.5% of all courses will be delivered virtually. There will be no in-class courses with the exception of some very few labs and very few music courses.
20 seconds.
And so we will be virtual. We have canceled our intercollegiate athletic season, the entire conference, and we will be completely virtual at least until the beginning of the spring semester, but possibly for the entire academic year 2021.
Thank you, Tomas. Manuel, same question for you.
Good. Definitely, you know, this has been an ongoing process. We have, as soon as we started classes after the lockout, we have had a continuous online tutorials for students. Also, we have a call center so we can answer any doubts the students have in the use of Blackboard Collaborate Ultra. Also, very important, we worked, many students, especially low-income students, maybe they didn't have the internet at home, or maybe they didn't have the laptop. They were using their iPhones to take the classes. And when the time came for the final exams, that represented a difficulty. Fortunately, we worked all the universities in Puerto Rico, public and private, working together. We went to the Fortaleza, the governor's office, and we said, here we need to make an exception. We can take And we got an authorization from Fortaleza that if the it was an open space and there was social distance and all the precautions were taken, the students would be able to take their on-site final exams. So that was very important for those students that didn't have the means to take the online final exams. With the CARES Act, we worked very efficiently. I think we were able to channel the student funds in a record time. I have to mention that Inter-American had total grant for Inter-American was $59 million, out of which 29 were for the students. As you all know, the Secretary of Education, DeVos, sent a letter with the guidelines, and one of the purposes of those funds was technology. So we strongly advise students, especially low-income students, that we anticipated that the summer program and the fall semester at least would be online courses. Therefore, we highly recommended as much as possible to use those funds to acquire a laptop if they didn't have one. And I think that students follow the advice. And as a result, I want to mention that our summer enrollment went beyond projections. We had more students than expected for the summer program. So I think we're doing okay so far.
Thank you, Manuel. Carlos. And mute, you're on mute.
Yeah, there is someone that is not in mute, that is not a panelist. Please make sure your microphone is mute. Thank you.
Carlos, you are on mute. You need to unmute. We cannot hear you. Go ahead.
Thank you very much. Let me start by saying that we at the university have had a very robust online program over the years. And so we, like most of you, had to switch over from the standard face-to-face classes to the remote learning environment. We also provided a 1 week time off for the faculty in the middle of the semester for them to develop in transition to the remote learning environment, which in some cases was Zoom or maybe even Moodle in our case. But in other cases, it really was more challenging in the case of practical courses, laboratories or so. The faculty had to look for other means of doing it, including purchasing kits for the classes or even doing simulations through some of the software that's available. So anyway, that transition took place and we were very pleased with the way it happened. We continue to offer we also transitioned many of our support services to online virtual advising and tutoring was transitioned. The other thing that we did is we also made sure that our counseling and disability services office was very proactive in contacting and working with the students. Am I the only one hearing that noise? No, okay, thank you.
I already put the person in mute, sorry. Please put your microphone in mute, thank you.
So overall, we were, I think we transitioned very quickly to a remote learning environment. I must also say to you that we sent all the staff home for a few weeks so that we, the staff, the administrative staff, also operated from home during this period of time. And then recently we started returning to offices on campus, and we've done that on a very carefully thought out way by having every office submit a plan as to how they propose to return back to the offices on campus. And that has been going very well because we've been able to address some of the concerns of the staff in terms of returning home. In some cases, we're exploring working from home on a longer term basis. I will also say in terms of how we have worked with the students that are low income, we set up institutions an emergency relief fund. You said 30 seconds?
20.
20. emergency relief fund. We provided a refund for students, of course, when they were sent home from the university for the room and board fees. We used the CARES funding to provide funding for the students. We also have made available emergency funds from the United Way organization. And we also have a pantry on campus that the students have been able to access. Because the students don't purchase books here, they actually rent them. We provided funding for them to send them at no cost to them back to the institution. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. The next theme is about the future after COVID-19. And one of the questions that I have is, what do you think a new educational paradigm looks post-COVID-19? And I would like Carlos Vargas to start this round of questions and answers. Go ahead.
Thank you very much, Carlos. I think one of the things that this situation has created it has had as a result the fact that the universities have actually done things now that they've been talking about for a long time and not quite implemented. This idea of using technology to for teaching and learning, the reality is many of our faculty members, when we had to move to remote learning environment, didn't have the skills and the competencies required to actually do the teaching themselves. So they really had to do that very quickly. So now people have lost the fear. They have lost the fear. And just like with any other technology, I see now people are starting to say, hey, look, we can do this and we can try that, because now they are already using the technology. And I don't think that's going to go away ever. Mm-hmm. So I think we're now going to be starting to see an optimization of the use of technology for teaching and learning that is going to be quite transformational, I think, for higher education.
Thank you. The same question, Manuel.
You know, I fully agree with what Carlos just said. I think the faculty, that many of them were uneasy or maybe even afraid of the new technology, they are beginning to like it. Not only the faculty, the students. I have so much feedback from students saying that even though it's distance learning, they feel closer to their professors. There's more communication with them. So I think that I don't know when it's going to be post-COVID. I guess the question is, what's going to happen immediately? And then after that, post-COVID could be within 1 year, 2 years from now. But definitely, I think things are not going to be the same. I think there has been a sudden change, and many students and even many professors are going to prefer the use of this type of teaching using, in our case, Blackboard Collaborate. For example, if a student is absent, he can view the class afterwards. Mm-hmm. So there are so many benefits from this type of teaching. I think as a result of this, I think we're going to be seeing in the future more hybrid courses, a combination of on-site classes and distance learning classes.
Thank you. Tomas, if you can give us your perspective on the future after COVID.
First, I have to say hello to my great mentor, President Emeritus Ricardo Fernandez. Ricardo has been such a great mentor to so many of us. So, saludos, Ricardo. We will find that the new paradigm will essentially be a hybrid, embracing the expansion of technology while also confirming the values of the college experience in the lives of our students. Online learning has been increasing in higher education, while not universally adopted by all in the academy. Its contributions to wider access, cost effectiveness, time efficiency, while creating a pathway to a degree without the traditional brick and mortar infrastructure. The pandemic has sped up the clock. Instead of moving at a measured pace, we now find ourselves rushing to catch up or risk being left behind. As is always the case, necessity will foster innovation. New hardware, new software, new methods, new ideas will lead to breakthroughs that will go beyond anything most of us can presently imagine. At the same time, the past few months of forced change have allowed us to recognize how certain things that we do have a tremendous effect on the future. Education isn't just about grades, exams, and degrees. It's about discovery. It's about recognizing the individual within the bigger picture. When students are on campus, they are part of a learning community. They are exposed to different opinions, alternative actions, diverse cultures, and a wide variety of viewpoints. They are introduced to global workplace and learn how to communicate and collaborate. These are the tools that will change the world because they always have. As institutions, our mission is to provide students the knowledge and understanding they need to succeed. We also instill in them the confidence that they can be successful. As institutions of higher education, we cannot provide the level of student success we seek to achieve without equity. The big issue is the funding of education, ensuring access for all students. The COVID-19 pandemic has tremendously increased the strain on already overstretched institutional budgets. Even before the outbreak, HSIs were scrambling for equitable federal funding. According to HACU, for every dollar in federal funding that non-HSI schools receive, HSIs just get 68 cents. All this at a time when more Latinos than ever are attending college.
Thank you, Tomas, for that perspective. David, if you can give us yours.
I echo the sentiments of the other presidents. I think we're all seeing the same thing. You know, we've crossed the Rubicon and there's no going back. You know, we're going to see more hybrid instruction, more distance learning. Telecommuting will be part of our business model. And as Manuel pointed out, I think the fear and resistance of technology is going to be greatly reduced. And that was always a hurdle that we had difficulty getting over. But, you know, technology with all its power and potential also has some limitations, and Tomas touched on this. Social isolation, the inability to interact. And I think for me, it also heightens the differences of wealth and what people have access to, and it brings those into sharp relief. But moving forward, I think, and I'm not sure if this is a good thing or a bad thing, but we as an educational community are going to be forced to confront a very fundamental question. And that is, what is the difference between information and education? Mm-hmm. We have been bombarded with data on all sources. And I think Tomas kind of summarized it beautifully. when we start thinking about how we get our students to think critically, to analyze, to challenge, and to think, is where, for me, you find the difference between just going to the internet and getting data and really being an educated man or woman.
Thank you. Maritza, la misma pregunta. Si puedes, adelante.
Sí, a ver, miren, yo estoy de acuerdo con las intervenciones anteriores. Yo quisiera apuntar unos elementos adicionales. La historia ha demostrado que en todas las crisis, en pandemias y en guerras, se han acelerado unos procesos. Y esta no fue la diferencia. Y sobre todo en educación. Y seguramente en los países podemos encontrar unas diferencias importantes. Yo quisiera, hay unos elementos que convergen y que son iguales, pero aquí en Colombia está sucediendo un tema muy interesante, y es que esta situación aceleró muchos procesos de incorporar tecnologías. Déjenme darles un dato. En Colombia la primera maestría virtual fue hace 25 años, y pasaron 20 años y no hubo ningún aumento en la matrícula de la educación virtual. En los últimos 2 años se ha ido aumentando la matrícula en la educación virtual, pero no solamente porque no haya demanda, es que tampoco ha habido oferta. Hoy, todas las instituciones, para poder sobrevivir a esta situación, nos tocó hacer educación remota. Con ese comentario, hay varios elementos que van a ser los paradigmas desde mi óptica. Uno, entender que la convergencia de las tecnologías también hizo que convergieran las modalidades y que ya no hay fronteras. No hay fronteras entre que este programa es virtual cuando o este programa es presencial cuando. Esta convergencia va a permitir que el estudiante seleccione cómo va a querer tomar su curso, si blended, si virtual o si presencial. Ese es un paradigma que por lo menos en lo que yo estoy viendo aquí en mi país se rompe. Dos, sistemas educativos más resilientes, sistemas educativos más adaptables. Y no solamente las personas, las políticas, las estrategias, y entender la resiliencia como un elemento importante para el buen vivir, para superar adversidades y para también superar barreras que limitan en algún momento la creatividad y las oportunidades. Pero además hay un elemento que también me parece que nos está generando esta ruptura de paradigma, y es entender que la caracterización de los estudiantes debe ser de 360 grados y de los profesores. ¿A qué me refiero? No basta con saber aspectos demográficos del estudiante y del profesor. No basta con saber la edad, si trabajan, si son casados, si tienen hijos, si es magíster, si es doctor, los años de experiencia. No. Es una caracterización 360 grados, es ir más allá, ir al ser, ir a inclusive a tener unos elementos de contexto. Yo desde allí creo que estas rupturas nos van a enseñar y nos están enseñando a ser mucho más adaptables y a ser mucho más predictivos, que ese es el último elemento que quisiera decir. Pasar de tener unas acciones correctivas a ser mucho más predictivos en medir aprendizajes, en medir deserción. Y para esto tenemos que usar todas las oportunidades que nos está dando la inteligencia artificial. Y ahí hay que romper un paradigma muy importante. No es decir que desertó el 20% cuando ya están por fuera. Es como desde antes soy predictiva como institución, como política, y no llego a que deserte ese 20%.
Muchas gracias. Chancellor Rondón indicates that she's in agreement with many of the previous thoughts, and she believes that history accelerates change, and in this case, of course, education is not the exception. And in the case of Colombia, it has accelerated the incorporation of instructional technology at a fast speed. She uses the example of the first virtual master's degree, which was developed 25 years ago or more, but then it has been 20 years without an increase in the tuition for those type of programs. And similarly, not an increase in those programs in the offers. So she indicates that it's not due to the lack of demand, but is maybe due to other reasons. She's of the belief that this particular situation we are all living has accelerated the convergence of technologies and modalities, and that there's no difference at this moment how education is happening, and that the student will have a greater role and a greater voice in choosing and deciding where and how he learns, because that's going to be the new paradigm. The second aspect she says is that we need to start thinking on developing educational systems that are more adaptable and more resilient, because resilience will be the point of reference for everything we do moving forward in terms of living, educating ourselves, and working as well. Finally, she points to the new way of assessing the student, if it can be translated that way, that is not only the demographics, that is more than that, it's a 360 degree approach that will allow us to be more predictable in what we do with students in terms of transactions, and that we also leverage artificial intelligence in ways that allow us to avoid being reactive and being more proactive. So thank you. Gracias por la contestación. With that said, I just want to provide a 1 minute. This is going to be very, very fast for each of the panelists. If they can just summarize how this crisis compares with any other crisis they may have managed. Okay, so you have 1 minute to share with us that perspective, and then from that we will provide four questions and answers to the audience. So, Rectora Rondón, si nos puede decir qué otra crisis ha sido, se ha comparado con el COVID y cómo la trabajó.
Bueno, no, nosotros en Colombia no es que hayamos vivido una crisis como el COVID, simplemente la historia cuenta, por ejemplo, todas las guerras del Medio Oriente, cuando un momento en que no se podía servir, no se podía dar el estudio de la educación y empezaron a incorporar tecnología de una manera tan incipiente, resultó siendo una estrategia también para proteger a la mujer para que tuviera acceso a la educación. En ese sentido es mi comentario. Las diferentes historias que se han documentado de cómo en la educación, por ejemplo, en Europa, una época en los principios de 1900, también que hubo una enfermedad y empiezan a buscar los mecanismos para que la gente tenga acceso a la... No me acuerdo exactamente el nombre, pero era la fiebre algo, y empezaron a buscar mecanismos por la radio para poder llevar educación, y la gente también en un tema sin precedentes es el COVID, pero sí hay unas estrategias y unas historias atrás donde han enseñado a que hay que acelerar los procesos para seguir impartiendo la educación. Y quizás lo más relevante podrían leer todo lo de las guerras del Medio Oriente, que resultó favoreciendo la educación de la mujer.
Gracias. Chancellor Rondón indicates that, of course, there's no reference for COVID, but she alludes to wars that have occurred in the past, and that all those activities have led to a faster adoption of technology, which has then led to a movement that have had created circumstances for women to be protected and then afforded the ability to and the access to education. And she's mentioning various elements or parts of history where that has been validated. And she also mentions what happened in the 1900s in Europe, which is the Spanish flu, I guess she was alluding to that, which in some, all of these have accelerated the incorporation of technologies, whatever that is at that time, but also processes that have resulted in access to education by women. The same question, David Gomez, crisis pasada, I mean, previous crisis, and something similar now. So go ahead, 1 minute.
As the chancellor said, I think it is by definition unprecedented. We've never seen anything like this before. I've lived through the city's bankruptcy in 1975, the disaster of the 9/11 attacks. I've never seen anything that reflects the loss of life, the economic turmoil, and the fear and uncertainty of the future that is impacting our students. And I think it's revealed both the best in us as educators, and in some cases, the worst in us. So I believe that the lessons that we've learned, and some of them that have been shared today, are things that we will build on moving forward. And I'm eternally grateful to my colleagues, although I'll be stepping down shortly myself, because I think these are lessons that everyone can benefit from.
Thank you. Tomás.
Well, yeah. You know, this is, as David said, unprecedented. I mean, I have, you know, while I don't live in Puerto Rico, my family lives in Puerto Rico in San Sebastian, and I, you know, I know that what happened with Maria and the recent earthquakes have disrupted higher education. And as a kindred spirit, as a Puerto Ricano, I feel, even though I'm not living there, my colleagues have suffered tremendously, and the island has suffered tremendously. 9/11, I lived through that period with David. I know CUNY, they just came out with a, Inside Higher Education came out with a very interesting story that CUNY has suffered the most deaths of any system in the United States. So COVID is unprecedented. You know, we can talk about budget cuts, we can talk about other disruptions of our lives as higher education, as educators. So COVID-19, I think, is unprecedented. I just can't think of any other event that has impacted and will continue to impact. I'm convinced that we
10 seconds.
That we will be dealing with this one way or the other for the next 12 months, easy.
Thank you. Manuel, your perspective.
Yes, again, I agree with David and Tomás that this is unprecedented. And for example, I can tell you last April, when I was submitting to the consideration of the Board of Trustees, the budget for next year, I said, this is an act of faith. I have no idea of how many students are going to be enrolling next fall, because I don't know if they are going to take 1 year off the university because of the current situation. So we're trying to do planning, and actually we are reacting moment by moment to the crisis and trying to rethink all the plan we had done for the university for the next 3 years. We are rethinking all of that. So this is a new ball game, never before. Even in Maria, you were recovering. Now we are still dealing with the problem. So difficult time, that's it, unprecedented.
Thank you. Carlos, your perspective, you are on mute.
Thank you very much. I would like to say this is not the end of it. There will be another crisis, there will be another pandemic, there will be something else that is going to affect civilization as we know it. So I think what we need to do, and what I think this is showing the whole world, because this is affecting the whole world, is that we really need to be ready to adapt to circumstances that are changing. It's actually very sad. When I talk to people are very scared of the fact that they this, they may not go back to what it was, that we may not go back to what it was. And that's very troubling to people, to all of us as human beings. So, but the reality is we are going to have to be willing to plan for changes that are going to take place. There's no doubt about that. I can see another, if you have heard Dr. Fauci, the director of the Institute for Diseases, Infectious Diseases, he says in his 40 years of practice, he has never come across a virus that has so many manifestations and affects people in ways that in one case the person dies, in another case the person has a cough for about 2 days and that's over. Mm-hmm. In another case they have problems with diabetes, and another case they have problems with a different kind of problems, kidneys and all that. So he says this is unprecedented, and that just shows that things are going to continue to evolve. So we need to continue to understand that. And I think that this just shows the fact that education is so critical for all of us. We need to continue to prepare people to be ready to respond to this in a proactive way. And the only way to do that is to have people educated. And that's our responsibility. So the one thing that I say is, The way that the universities are operating right now is going to change dramatically. This brick and mortar environment is going to have to change in ways that are really unpredictable in some ways. So I like the idea of this pandemic having disrupted higher education. It has disrupted every one of the different elements of life in the world as we see it. So I just think that we need to continue to be flexible and to be ready to change.
Thank you. Thank you. All right. I want to, of course, acknowledge all the perspectives shared this afternoon here. Very, very informing for us. We have reached the point of a Q&A, question and answers for to our panelists. I'll ask Jubelkis to, she has been managing the chat page. So if you can bring us one of those questions and go ahead, Jubelkis.
Sí, actually, Yelitza was, I was paying attention of who was on mute to mute it. Yelitza was the one copying all the questions. Yelitza, could you please share? Because we have questions since the beginning, so we don't want to miss anyone. And please don't go, because this is the most important part. Although we are recording, we encourage you to stay for the Q&A. So, Yelitza, please.
You are on mute.
Yelitza, are you there? Okay, but
can you hear me?
Yes, now. You were on mute.
Okay. I lost audio from the computer, so I was listening from the phone, sorry.
Okay.
So the first question, it's from Victor Concepcion Santiago, and it's addressed to Dr. David Gomez. This was in regards of question one, and the question is, what do you mean by credit or no credit courses? How does no credit benefit the students?
Well, the intent, and I know it's been implemented a little differently in different institutions, the intent was to not adversely affect the student's grade point average. So if a student, let's say, is a straight A student, and because of the middle of the semester suffered in the transition, that they would opt either to get credit for the course or NC, which would not impact them negatively. And in, at least in CUNY's case, there was also the ability for the student to repeat the course so as not to lose progress. So it was really a way of trying to protect the students, many of whom, we've had a couple that had 4.0 GPAs and wanted to make sure that this circumstance did not adversely impact them. So it was an option, not a requirement.
Thank you. Another question, Yelitza.
Yes.
Yelixa,
let me read the chat. I'm trying to, okay, Dr.
Yes,
Gomez was the one.
Sure that I don't make any
okay, Yelixa, I can hear you.
So the next question was for, from Dr. Marian Toledo, and it was for Dr. Rendon. She was saying saying that the psychologic support was very excellent, and also if she can talk a little bit about the telepsychology and involving their human resources on this support.
Por favor, ¿me pueden traducir?
Sí, rectora, lo que usted discutió sobre telepsicología,
sí.
Si puede abundar un poco más en qué consiste la iniciativa.
Sí.
Brevemente, pues, por favor.
Nosotros en Colombia no teníamos permitido hacer la telepsicología, solamente se estaba permitido hacer la telemedicina. Pero en esta contingencia, el Ministerio de Salud y la Asociación, aquí tenemos una asociación de facultades de psicología muy, muy fuerte en Colombia, se unieron y nos dieron unos lineamientos y unos protocolos para que podamos hacer consulta psicológica por estos medios. No estaba permitido y nosotros activamos esos protocolos con todos los esquemas de confidencialidad, obviamente de seguridad, en todo lo que tiene que ver con el uso de estas tecnologías, para poder hacer acompañamiento por estos medios. De hecho, les quiero decir que las prácticas que estaban orientadas solamente a hacer de manera presencial los estudiantes de psicología en Colombia, también pudieron hacer las prácticas por este esquema y de esa manera terminaron su semestre sin problema. No quedó nada pendiente porque el ministerio lo habilitó. Si gustan, me regalan el nombre, creo que es la doctora María, si no estoy mal, la entendía Yulixa, y con mucho gusto te puedo mandar los protocolos y las, los documentos que construimos para poder hacer esta práctica de telepsicología.
Gracias. Maritza says that before telepsychology was not allowed in Colombia, it is now allowed simply because the circumstances then, you know, forced them to think differently. She indicates that protocols were created in terms of allowing this service to be delivered, as well as, or with an emphasis in confidentiality, as well as security, as you involve now technology to mediate this type of service. She also highlights the fact that students in the program of psychology, they're what used to be a face-to-face practice, was conducted using this method as well. So the protocols allow for the delivery of the service of those that already are psychologists, but also the newly formed students in psychology. Gracias. Next question, if we have any.
Sí, estoy bien. Estoy viendo aquí una de Víctor Concepción. Question.
¿Me escuchan?
Yelixa, I'm doing the question of Victor Concepcion. Please make sure we don't leave anyone else before. But the question of Victor is, does any of the panelists have any assessment survey that provides information related to faculty, administrator, and students' opinion on their experience using distant education during COVID-19 past semester?
Anybody wants to answer that? Do you have any
survey
data?
We have conducted surveys for students primarily and faculty, and the preliminary results are something of a mixed bag. I'll be more than happy, Yubelkis, to transmit the information we do have so that people can look at it. But, you know, as Manuel pointed out earlier, the overwhelming majority report a high degree of satisfaction, but there are always some who are very vocal who are not so happy. But I'll be more than happy to share it in its entirety.
Thank you.
I would like also to mention that the number of faculty members retiring this year has increased as compared to previous years. Definitely there are some members of the faculty that think at this time of their life, changing their whole process of teaching is out of the question. So definitely there are many retiring because of that. Again, I think we have to make, we're working also on making a survey, but it's still in process.
Thank you. I think we have time for one more question.
We have a question from Delia Cruz Medina to President Fernos. Was some stipend with given to professors? And also, And also, Dr. Go ahead. We have another one.
Our faculty handbook says that it's the responsibility of the faculty to develop and learn new ways teaching techniques. So that's part of their job. But let me tell you this: I want to first of all recognize and I want to give the thanks to all the faculty members of Inter-American because they use their personal laptops during this process. And we are buying with the CARES Act institutional funds new laptops for all faculty members for the fall semester. So they're gonna get help with the new technology thanks to the funds from CARES Act.
Thank you. Okay.
One last question to you, Carlos.
For me. Okay.
Belinda Rosario asks, what application are you using for translation?
It is the one and only myself.
Excellent.
Yeah, it was excellent. But before we go, we have a surprise because as you may know, let me share something very quickly. Okay. I cannot share, espérate. As you may know, Carlos, you are part of this. Ay, Dios mío, no puedo, I can't share. As you may know, David Gomez, President Gomez, this is the last event with us as president of Hostos Community College, since he's retiring from this position, effectively in July, right?
It's correct.
Yeah, in July. So yesterday board meeting was his last one, and today is I hope that in the future you can join us in any other event, but as president of Hostos, it have been a pleasure to collaborate with you, and also I would like your colleagues in the panel and any other member like Ricardo and others, if they have some words to share with David, since we have it here, and we couldn't be able to be face-to-face in a meeting to do a proper, farewell event as we usually do, since you know board members are more than members, are a family, and heads is distinguished because of that. So please, if someone else want to share a few words, this is a moment. Sorry for the participants who are taking this time, but he definitely deserve it.
Thank you
for the service, David.
David, I think we are gonna miss you all. But let me recall the words MacArthur said to Congress. All soldiers never die, they just fade away. So we all hope to see you around as we are seeing today, Ricardo Fernando. It's a pleasure to see you, Ricardo, again.
Thank you.
All right. Any other comments to David? Okay, all right. Well, I want to thank everybody's attendance this afternoon and attention to this topic on COVID and the perspective and experiences learned from five institutions. Again, thank you for the opportunity. Be safe and be well, and we'll see you in a future HEADS event. Take care.
Thank you to everyone. And remember that the certificates has to be requested by email, because we don't have a recording of the chat. So if you put the email on the chat, it's gonna be loose. We will be sending the link to this recording so you can share with others. Thank you so much for your time, and hope to see you in our future events. Have a great day, and thank you, Carlos, for your excellent moderation.
Hola, Hilda.
Yeah. Thank you, everyone.
Gracias, Maritza.
Saludos a Colombia.
Aterrada, yo decía, ¿será que tiene una grabación allá y ahora la...